right, good morning, Oak Leaf. If you want to stand and join us in praising Jesus' name this morning.
Oh, don't lose heart, oh, my soul.
Open the gates of heaven, lift up the shadow of prayer.
We're all together, together, waiting here as one. We're waiting here as one. Sing it again. There is power, power, here in this hour, this hour.
Wow. Holy Toledo, man. I don't know where you're at on that idea, this hour, but I have been praying this week and with unusual fervency for God to do something in this hour. So let's pray together. God, we love you. We bless you. We praise you. God, thank you for the band. They just always lift up my soul, Lord. It's such good stuff, Lord. We praise you for your word. And we ask you once again, God, would you show us beautiful things from your word? And God, may we, like James says, not just be hearers of your word, but doers for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God together said, amen, amen. You can be seated, amen. And let the band know you love them. You got to let them know you love them, because they love them. I appreciate Bradley. Bradley's been different jobs that he's been through, and his previous job wouldn't let him be here. They had to work, but now he has an opportunity where he can come some Sundays. And so for teenagers, they really like to just sleep in. And you ask the teenager and say, hey, man, you come to the church on Sunday. They're like, do what now? That is my sleep day, you know? And then they always get me, Sabbath. Oh my God, great. Okay, thank you. Yeah, it is a Sabbath, but so I'm grateful that that Bradley has the heart to help and gifted in the drumming. I can remember when he was a little kid and it was not sounding good at home, okay? In Jesus' name, it was not sounding good at home. And I thought that the devil himself told, you know, Bradley that play drums, but I thought it was the devil. I was like, no, God has not spoken to you to play drums, no. But God clearly had spoken, and he's a gifted young man. And I was telling Jesse, too, when the band comes out and they play, it's a beautiful picture of how the church ought to be, and that is you've got all of these different instrumentations and diversity that's up here, and individually it's just one thing that they would do. It probably would sound pretty good. But together, there's movement to it, and there's an inhabitation from God. He says, I will inhabit the praises of my people. And so what a beautiful picture for us to just lean in and follow that same example. It's just good stuff. I want to get started this week by repeating an illustration from our last series. And thank you for your kindness. I got a lot of emails and text messages about the last series. Matter of fact, I was in the line at Chick-fil-A, and somebody had said to me, hey, I really appreciate a worker that was working there. He's in the back right now. He's got his hat on. But anyways, great kid. He had said, his name's Gabe, but he's back there. Anyways, he had said, hey, man, I really enjoyed your series. And when a young person says that, and then he says something to the effect that, man, it's just really relevant to our day and speaking into what, you know, we need to hear. And so I was so encouraged by that. So thank you, my brother. Amen. I got that blessing, and then I got a blessing of a chicken nugget. Amen. You doesn't get any better than that. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, I want to get started by looking back at that series and just one illustration, because when God gave me the illustration, I always pray through these illustrations and say, God, how do you want to take an abstract idea, an abstract truth, and make it concrete, make it come alive in our minds so that we get it? Because Jesus was the best at that. You know, Jesus was doing the greatest talks in the world long before there were TED Talks, okay? Jesus was killing it, man. He told stories and people understood what was happening, unless he wanted to say it in such a way that they couldn't understand it. And there was a purpose in the parables in that. But so I prayed and God gave me this illustration. But when he gave me the illustration, he also laid a massive burden on my soul that the church is going through an unprecedented time of spiritual warfare. And I'm not the guy that looks for a demon behind every bush. I'm like, you go get the demon, Jesus. Amen. You go take care of the demons. I'm not the guy who's going to go chasing them down. But it was so overwhelming, and I wanted to bring it into one of my points in the last message, but God said, no, I want you to do a little standalone two-week deal, and I want you to speak on this, and I want you to speak into it. Because my people need to hear what's going on. So I'm gonna share this illustration again and then point at the particular thing that God is saying to us through it. If you remember, if you were here, I talked about the Black Death or the bubonic plague. It swept through Asia, Europe, and Africa from 1340 to 1353, and it killed an estimated 200 million people. The small village of Bergen, Germany, with its population of 1,500, was really hit hard. Once you contracted the plague, check this out, it only took 10 days to die. The villagers, made up of farmers and fishermen, went house to house trying to care for the sick and bury the dead. But all the while, listen to this, 50 Christians of St. Mary's Church, oldest building still standing in that city today, right there, these Christians, with food that was given to the church as tithes, and they had a well for water in it, decided to wait out the plague atop of these twin towers. While they did it, 1,000 people perished in 3 weeks. 500 others fled to the mountains. And when the so-called saints came down from their towers, they discovered a small boy dead in a sitting position, crouched at the church doors. Cold and blue, he clutched a note given to him from the villagers for the church. Here is a painting of the note that's on display at that church. It's to inspire future generations that deal with the plague not to commit their crime. And it reads, and I'm not good at German, but I think I'll get this, Wo bist du? And in English, it means, where are you? Imagine that. Where are you? We're dying. We're fleeing. Where are you? Now, we are to be in the world, but not of it. But dare we, like those selfish Christians of yesteryear, scale our towers of self-preservation and hide from the plague of sin that's eating our society alive? May it never be said of Oak Leaf, where are you? Now, this is currently a valid question, and listen carefully, because since COVID, the average attendance in churches across America has declined 50%. Look at that arrow. Since COVID, 50% have not come back. Are you hearing me? 50% of people who were going to church before COVID haven't returned. Now, we should be asking a question, why is that happening? And I've got an answer, Satan, amen. Satan, that's right, Satan. Don't forget what we learned last week about the devil. Let's remind ourselves again, 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the what? Devil walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may what? Tickle? Seeking whom he may tickle? No, devour. 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war, there's a war going on, according to the flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Jesus Christ. There is a war going on. And 2 Corinthians 4:4 makes it so crystal clear. In their case, the God of this world, little g God, Satan, has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Now, how is Satan launching this war? What is Satan's game plan? Well, we learned last week that he has a mind-oriented strategy. He's going after the mind. And when he goes after the mind, listen, he is called the father of what? Say it again, the father of what? He is a liar. He is a liar. The strange thing about a lie is it sounds like a truth. The strange thing about a lie is it will be told in the context of some things that might prove it to be true. But he is a liar. And there are three major lies that he has unleashed on the church. And today, I would like to take some time to debunk every one of those demonic lies. Amen. Three of them. Is this thing on? Amen. Is this thing on? Because I'm about to debunk some lies from the devil. We are going to go at it for the glory of God. And listen to this. Here is the first lie. This is the very first lie. Gatherings should be abominated. They should be loathed. They should be detested. 50% of the people who bailed, that's right, I'm calling them bailers, said when polled, listen to this, when polled, why haven't you come back? Here's a basically like a collage of their answers together to make one particular point. They say, well, this is the position caring and thoughtful people have taken. And if you gather, you're not caring and thoughtful. Gatherings should be avoided like the plague because we're in a plague. If you don't recognize that, then you're effectively a hateful and harmful Christian putting millions at risk. Really? Really? The caring and thoughtful people of the world have said gatherings should be avoided like the plague. They should be abominated. Really? Really? Okay. Let's just take a look at what's really going on as it relates to gatherings. Just... ...41,000 people at that game. That's a lot of people. Might have been 8 masks in that whole group. Here's another one. Y'all remember this game? You should. 65,000 people were at that game. 65,000.
Time for a team to unleash a soul.
Look at all the people in the background behind him. 72,000 people were meeting.
Right here, right now, ladies and gentlemen, the champions of the NFC, your Los Angeles Rams.
And they just so happened to have went on and won that battle. By the way, according to the attendance records at ESPN.com, 92 million people attended professional athletic competitions in the United States in 2021. I got a question. Where are the protesters? Did anyone cancel baseball? Did anyone cancel football? Did anyone cancel the Super Bowl? It's a lie! It is a flat-out lie. But Satan is feeding us a lie. And like Eve did in the garden, the church, not the world, the church, take a look at our empty seats, and we only have one service, and we got the greatest thing going on in the world. But the church, not the world, is eating this lie. Wake up! Yeah, I hope you're listening to me. Wake up! I propose to you that Satan has unleashed his greatest war against Christianity since the persecution of the early church. And we must not hide in our towers of self-preservation while Satan is attempting an annihilation of Christ's church in America. Amen. You listen to me. We are at a crossroads in history. And Lord forbid the world who needs God's redemptive intervention cry out to us, "Where are you?" Man, the words of Hebrews 10:25 ring truer than ever before in my soul. Not forsaking our meeting together as believers for worship and instruction, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more faithfully as you see the day of Christ's return approaching. Whew. One last thing. If anyone is using this time of COVID to get lazy, to get complacent, to hide in the twin towers of your self-preservation, in the name of Jesus, repent and return. Repent and return. Why? Don't forget, beloved, I may have a hard word this morning, but please believe me, beloved. Prophecy is unfolding. Christ will return. And what will that moment look like when you see Jesus and he finds you hiding? Is this thing on? Amen. Is this thing on? It is a lie. A flat out crazy lie. That gatherings should be abominated. The world's not abiding that. What are they saying? Well, don't do as we do as we say. And the church said, okay. We're just gonna walk around fearful. When we're the ones that God said, he's not given us a spirit of fear. Yes. Amen. Yes. So, with a little bit of excitement in my soul, because I do believe that God has given a strong word. And by the way, as you go out and you interact with other people, I'm giving you something to say. I'm giving you something to say. That lie does not need to be put on our shoulders. It is a lie from hell. You can go back this next week and you can take them to those videos, just those three. By the way, I could have given a lot more because 92 million people went to games. And it's a lie. And the church is the one that's bought into it. 50%, that's not happened in the history of America, in the history of the world, where 50% of the people that were coming to church within a period of 1 year are gone. And listen, thousands of churches have closed their doors. But praise God, not Oak Leaf. Amen. Come on, amen. We ain't closed them. Here's lie number two. Lie number two. I told you I'm going to break down three lies. Here's lie number two. The church is antiquated. Just antiquated. They're saying, the world is saying, and if you do any of the polls and if you go into any Facebooks or you go to any blogs that are out there about these particular subjects, you will find it so loud and so clear. They are saying this because they believe people have decided Jesus is irrelevant, especially young people. Therefore, we should see the inevitable, the proverbial writing on the wall, and just shut the doors because church is outdated, and it's antiquated. Excuse me, is this thing on? Hold on a second. Really, especially the young people? I invite you to watch the video screen again. Here in Atlanta. Amen. Yeah, do that. Yeah, I like that. Yeah. Woo! Because, really? 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 So, it's antiquated. Jesus is irrelevant. Really? Well, there were 65,000 during the COVID period, 65,000 for Passion Conference that met in the Mercedes-Benz big giant Mac Daddy deal down there, declaring that Jesus is completely relevant. Amen. Well, it's just old. There's nobody else is following this thing. Just the old people just kind of hold on to it. That's a lie from hell. It is a lie from hell. Amen. These people were saying that Jesus is not irrelevant. Therefore, his church is not antiquated. It may be old in news in terms of years, but it's not old in terms of an expiration date like bad milk and should be thrown away. No way. Jesus has what the world is screaming for, and these students know it. So when the world protests about climate change and save the planet, you know what they're doing? They're reaching for significance. They want to be a part of something that's going to last a whole lot longer than them, that has a lot of meaning to it, significance. When the people scream that their lives should matter, they're wanting validation, and rightly so. When the marginalized people storm the media, it's more than a sign that they are hungry for equality. And when thousands march and protest the war, it's proof positive that they are starving for peace. Guess what? Every one of those things that our world's going nuts about, we've got it in our first aid kit. Amen. The church has that in our first aid kit. Listen, significance. Significance? Okay. Well, check this out. Save the world, save the planet. Got it. But check this out. We're going to be a part of something that lasts for all of eternity. Revelation 21, 1 through 4. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. We've been so longing that which is invisible would be made visible, and that God would be right here with us, and we would be right there with him. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. And listen to what he's going to do. All that pain and all that heartache that people are feeling when they talk about climate change and they're talking about saving the planet, there's a lot of hurt that's involved, and I get that, but here's what's going to happen. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things, all the bad stuff that we want to stop, the former things have passed away. Amen. We've got significance. It's in our first aid kit. What about validation? I don't think we get any more greater validation than the God of the universe coming to earth to rescue you as an individual from your sin. For God so loved the world that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You matter. Humanity was suffering injustice from Satan. God came and rescued you, set you free from injustice, and he wants you to hang out with him for all of eternity. Listen to me. We can tell the world, you matter. Amen. Talk about validation. And equality? Are you kidding me? It started with God. Listen to this, Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female. We get all whacked out about gender. There's no male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. You know what God does? God obliterates human barriers from race to genders and emphatically says, we're all equal. Amen. It's in our first aid kit. The world's bleeding. The world is hurting. We've got this stuff. Listen to this last one, peace. The world is so hungry for peace. Listen to this, oh my goodness. Revelation 5, 9, and 10. And they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom, no more divided nations warring, and priests to our God, and they, all of us united, shall reign on the earth. The biggest, most influential, non-dysfunctional family on the planet is in Christ. Thank you. Thank you, Lorena. Thank you. I thought that was a great statement. I just thought it was great. And I don't know. Maybe you just don't have any dysfunction in your family. But I'm telling you, that was an anointed holy word from God right there. Amen. The biggest and most influential non-dysfunctional family on the planet is in Christ. And we get to be a part of it. No more family fights. No more wars, nation against nation. Peace for all of eternity. That's in our first aid kit. And the world's screaming for it. We have the remedy for our hurting, hungry world. But that will never make the major news networks. Don't look for it. Not going to happen. It's not. They're not going to go, hey, we just discovered how all the nations could stop fighting. Hey, we just discovered the panacea for dysfunctional families. You know, and all of a CNN, everybody just starts showing up at Oakleaf, you know, just all those trucks with the little, you know, giant little scope things on them, the funnels, and your satellite deals, they're all everywhere. Why? Because we got the answer. Don't look for the trucks to show up and start putting this on the news. Not going to happen. But I'm telling you, every week, newsworthy history is being made for the glory of God. Let me tell you something. Listen. Churches are repenting and returning. There is a current movement within this month where Christ's church is repenting and returning. I want you to take a look with me at a few of some snapshots from online services just this past week. Look at these. Shonda, we're going to stay on this one just for a minute. You remember we talked about this. Listen, in 2018... a mega church called the Golden Lampstand Church. By the way, Tammy and I and our kids, we saw this church when we were in Beijing, China. The outside big building, full on for God. I mean, thousands and thousands of people. Well, they had their building exploded by the government. The government came in, ran everybody out with guns, put dynamite in it, blew it all up. This is a picture of them last week. They are not underground. They're meeting in public in another building, and they're packing it out. And they got a government that wants to blow their building up. What in the world is wrong with the church in America? I tell you what's wrong. Satan is winning a battle, and he shouldn't win it because we got the power of God in us. They're tapped into that power in China, man. You better believe it. Oh, check this out. I got some more. I'm not done. Here it comes. This is the Full Gospel Church in Seoul, Korea. You know what they have? Three times a week, they have prayer meetings, and the people show up to pray for 8 hours at a time on their knees before God. Look at that building. That is amazing. Now, this next one, here's the Holy Trinity in Portugal. Packed out. This next one, here's the Church of Jesus in Australia. Last week, packed out. This is the worship church in South Africa. See it there? It's packed out. This next one is the Ebenezer Church in the United States of America. Amen. The next one is Gateway Church in the United States of America. Hallelujah. The next one is Lakewood Church in the United States of America with John Gray preaching his head off. Amen. This next one is the Church of the Restored. Oh, wait, what are they doing? Are they holding hands? Super spreaders! The next one is the Bible Church in the United States. And finally, Second Baptist Church in the United States of America. Oakleaf, God is on the move. Let's not miss it. Let's be a part of it. And as long as there are people far from God, we will never close our doors. We'll keep gathering and we'll keep sharing good news, doing good deeds, because it's all for the greatest cause. Amen. The church is antiquated. Is this on? That's a lie. Yes. It is more relevant than it's ever been. It's not antiquated. So gatherings should be abominated. Boop, debunk that lie. That's a lie from hell. The church is antiquated. Are you kidding me? It's not like bad milk with an expiration date. You don't throw the church away. No way. And by the way, yeah, the statistics, 50%, but let me tell you something. Did you see those pictures? God is on the move, and people are repenting and returning. People are repenting and returning. Now, here's the last one. We're not motivated. The church is not motivated. That's huge. You go to any website on any kind of type of missiological. I didn't say church growth. I'm not into the church growth thing. Who cares? Let God grow his church. But we are all supposed to be on mission. So you start looking at some missiological websites and stuff, and you start checking some stuff out, and man, it becomes very, very clear that the church in America is not motivated. You let a church in America get its building blowed up, and you know what people do? They'll move their membership and they'll hide somewhere in a different church. Amen. We're not motivated. Now, this might not be a lie from the devil. It certainly is true for the way many Christians are acting today, and it could actually be true for some of us. I can tell you this, it's been true of me in many seasons of my life. Not motivated. Mm-mm. So let's do this. Let's make it a lie. It's the only one out of all these gets to still be a lie. It gets to be a lie. Let's make this thing a lie. Let's be motivated. Let's start inviting people like their eternity depends on it. I certainly try to preach like it. Last week, someone was visiting, and they said, "Wow, man, you sure are energetic and motivating." I said, "Okay, cool." And I said, "And I don't even drink Red Bull anymore." Amen. If I was drinking that stuff still, you guys have left a long time ago. You're like, Tony's running around the walls. It's crazy. But I began to think about that this week because this past week, February 24th, was my 33rd birthday in Jesus. And so I sent a text message to the man who led me to Jesus. I said, "Thank you so much for playing your role in that important day in me coming from death unto life." And then I sent another text to my friend Tommy Mallett, who was the pastor at the church that I was going to at that moment, called The Bridge. And I said, "Thank you for the role that you played in that moment, and thank you for preaching out of Ephesians for about, I don't know, 2 years." That book was such a foundational book for me. And I started thinking about it, like, wow, I 33 years in Jesus. And I even asked my wife, I talked to my wife about it. Have I been pretty motivated? Yeah. You're hyperly, extremely motivated. I've had some seasons where I've not been. I've had my fair share of, bad moments. I've had my share of church hurts. Not church hurt, church crush, church annihilation. I got nuclear bombed by the church. So I've had my moments where I'm like, I don't have anything to do with that. I've had my unmotivated moment. But for the most part, I'll say for 33 years and 7 months, I've been a fanatical, motivated person. And nobody has to call me. Nobody has to text me. Nobody has to send me an email. Nobody has to knock on my door. "Hey, come on, come to church, come on. And all the churches that I got, after I got saved, I went out to church. Every one of the churches had major moral failures in them. And big, giant fights over carpet and whether we're going to minister to divorced people. They kicked half the people out that wanted to do a ministry called Divorce Care. I'm like, "You guys are stupid. Kick me out too then, because we got to go after everybody. What are y'all, nuts?" Just every church, it was crazy. So I had plenty of reasons not to be motivated. But my eyes are fixed on the King. My eyes are fixed on the kingdom. And so I'm motivated. But if you ask me, like, what is it that has motivated you then for 33-something years? I've crisscrossed this country. Annabeth knows we were with Billy for I don't know how many years. Before that, we've been casting crowns for many, many years. Before that, we were just going everywhere to every church all over America, just sharing the gospel of Jesus. I looked at some of our records this past week. We've seen over 1 million people come to know Jesus as personal Lord and Savior. Incredible, crazy stuff. And what was it? Getting out there on the road, being away from home, being away from my kids, being in a hotel room, moldy hotel room, being on a bus with a bunch of stinky people, except for Billy. Billy's not stinky, but the rest of them were really stinky. Why do you do this? Why do you go? Why do you do this? Because I'm motivated. Yes. What's the big motivation? I thought about it this week, and I think Louis Giglio summed it up best with this statement he made in his tremendous book, I Am Not, But I Know I Am. If you don't have that book, you need to go buy that book. I Am Not, But I Know I Am. It's a small book, but it's so, man, it's so powerful. Listen to what he said. I've said this quote before from him, but I went back to the book and I got it right. Listen to this. Life is short. Our time on earth is brief. We have to make sure our lives count for the stuff that lasts forever. That's it. Like Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:14, Christ's love has moved me to such extremes, he said. His love has the first and last word in everything we do. Enjoy God's love. That's the foundation of all motivation, is the love of God. But Paul even said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, the amazing love of God. Look back over your shoulder. Hadn't he been good? Okay, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Looking at the love of God, that's the foundation. But right after I go from the foundation, I go to the forever with the motivation. Forever. 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 What's the stuff that lasts forever? Are you listening? People do. People do. And listen to me, we don't know when they will slip into forever. We don't know. We don't get to script this thing. Every once in a while, a doctor will say, you got 5 months to live. You got a year to live. And most people don't sign that piece of paper and go, yeah, okay, I'll die in 5 months. I'll die in a year. We try to prove them wrong. You know. But we don't get to script it. I have hundreds and hundreds of these stories, but I'll just try to share a few of them really quick. These are the ones that are always on my radar. I go to bed at night. They pop into my head. I try to be quiet, they pop into my head. I do my prayer drives, they pop into my head. And I weep. September of 2005, I preached at a camp. A little girl by the name of Nikki Mann. She's right there. No, go back one. Nikki Mann. Thank you, Shonda. She's a girl over here to your left, the tallest one. She's the oldest one. I led her to faith in Jesus at a retreat I preached at Crystal Lake, Florida. On January 25th, 2006, her and six of her relatives were in their car stopped behind a school bus that was letting out children when a semi-truck going 55 miles per hour without hitting its brakes slammed them into the bus. The car burst into flames and all of them were killed. That afternoon, when the grandfather heard the story that all of his grandbabies are gone, he had a massive heart attack and he died. That's why I'm motivated. People don't know when they will cross over into forever, but they do. And we are called by God to help them get ready for it. I don't care where you land, if you're a Calvinist, I don't care where you land, if you're an Arminianist, I don't care, Molinist, I don't care where you land, we can never get out of the responsibility of the Great Commission. We have been called by God to be on commission with him, that those who are far from God might meet Jesus and their lives be changed for all of eternity, because we will slip off into eternity. Friday, the next one here, Shonda, thank you. Friday, January 19th. 2007, I preached at the Sun Dome in Tampa, Florida. Ashley Michelle Harvey, she's there in that picture, 15 years old. She got saved that night. And 2 hours later, her car with other friends in the car with her was hit by a semi-truck, and they all died. 2 hours after getting saved, she met her God face to face. That's why I'm motivated. Is this thing on? That's why I'm motivated. Talk about cutting it close. 2 hours. This next one is a guy by the name of Barry Benton. On October 4th, 2015, I preached a one-day revival for Daniel's Association in Vidalia, Georgia. It was awesome. Little bitty old tiny church, and they believed that God was going to do some good stuff, so they rented out the high school little art center that they had just built there. The pastor said, we're going to have a bunch of people get saved. I said, okay, I'm believing with you. I preached the gospel, and we had scores come to Jesus. It was unbelievable. One of them was Barry Benton. He was 51 years old, and what I remember about him, he was a big old fella, and he was dressed in camo. You see him there, he's out with some camo on now. He's a camo hat. He had, it was cold, there was camo gloves, he had camo overalls, camo t-shirt, camo boots. I almost didn't see him. He had camo all over him. It's a camo everywhere. And I remember distinctively because he was the last one on a long line of people, and at that event, they had everybody leave and go into another room so counselors could minister to each one of them that had made this profession of faith. It was a beautiful moment. And I remember Barry looking at me, and he stood there while everybody else, he knew he was supposed to go with him, but he was waiting to make eye contact with me. And when I did, he pointed his finger at me, and then he did this. And I could see it in his eyes. He was crying. He was saying, like, hey, thanks for sharing the truth. I'm glad I was here today. That was October the 4th. Everybody talked about how radically saved Barry got. He was a very famous deer hunting guide in South Georgia. People would come from all over Georgia to go down with him, and they would hunt with him. He'd take them on these hunting excursions. And so his buddies showed up that Monday, and they showed up about 2 o'clock in the afternoon with their Jack Daniels and their Budweiser. And they pulled out of the truck. They were coming in. And they say, hey, we got what you really like, your Jack Daniels. And he was a heavy, heavy drinker. And he goes, hey, we won't be needing that, but I need all y'all to come in and sit down. So they all sat down. And he opened up the Bible, and he tried to preach a sermon that I just preached to him on Sunday. And they were all like, what just happened? What happened to Barry? What in the world? And then they said when they went out into their deer stands, they couldn't get any deer because he was scared them all away because he was trying to sing the praise songs that the band was singing that Sunday. He's just out there making a joyful growl to the Lord. And I just remember, like, wow, this is my man. What in the world happened to Barry? And he said, I'm telling you, I repent, God told me I'm a sinner, but he would save me. And I got saved. That was October the 4th. On October the 13th, while sleeping in his bed, two boys broke into his house and murdered him in his sleep. That's why I'm motivated. Finally, this is Patrick Price. He was already saved, born again, ate up with Jesus, great guy. I officiated his wedding with a young girl who worked in our ministry for 9 years, Brittany Brummel. We had a good wedding. It was so beautiful. And then they went on to have 3 kids. And Patrick knew Jesus. He was ate up with Jesus. And he worked in a bunch of different government offices. But his major passion was ministering to young boys and being a Sunday school teacher for young boys. He had poured his heart and life into 100 young boys. And a lot of them had grown older, and they all honored him. Patrick Price. At 30 years young, married only 4 years, one day at work, he stood up and he dropped dead with a cup of coffee in his hand. Just stood up behind his desk and dropped dead. He left behind his wife of 4 years and 3 little baby boys. Life is short. Our time on earth is brief. And we have to make sure our lives count for the stuff that lasts forever. I'll never forget officiating his funeral with my mentor, Dr. Johnny Hunt. And somebody had told me that the boys, they called them the boys, the kid that he had poured his life into, that they were all going to show, that none of them was missing the funeral. And I kind of heard that, and while I was given the thing, I said, you know, Patrick poured his life into some young boys. And if you're a young man who had his life poured into by Patrick and made a difference for all of eternity, would you stand up? There was 100 of these boys that wore white shirts, and they stood up all over that auditorium. What a legacy. Patrick believed life is short, our time on earth is brief, so we got to make sure that our lives count for the stuff that lasts forever. Would you stand with me, please? The question should be resonating in our hearts. What do we do with a message like this? Where there's more than 12 of us in the room, I'm nowhere near Jesus. Of course, Jesus changed the world with 12. He was Jesus. But we got more than 12 in this room. I wonder what could happen if we really all got motivated about eternity, about making sure that our lives count for the stuff that lasts forever. And people do. So it's simple, really. For those who are home and hiding, come down from your towers and come back to church. Repent and return. And please hear me. I'm a bit fanatical, but I'm not an idiot. So I understand if you have health issues. Please, be wise. Keep your distance. Do what you need to do to be safe. This is why we have this ministry online, because we are very understanding about that. So God bless you. And as I've said many, many times, I can't wait for the day that you can come. When you can, your health allows you, and I can hug your neck. But for those who don't have that excuse, in the name of Jesus, God is on the move. And you do not want to miss what God's about to do here at Oak Leaf. I beg you, come back. Just come. Matter of fact, I'm not begging you. I'm inviting you. God's not begging anybody. He's inviting you to come in. Come back. And to those who hang their head low thinking we're a part of some dying movement, well, we shouldn't talk about it during the week. It's a bit embarrassing if I bring it up because, I mean, it was kind of popular in the 50s and all that. But I mean, we're in the 2022s now, and it's antiquated. Lean into Jesus. Absorb the freshness of the power of his Spirit and realize, listen, this thing is just getting started. It's for all of eternity. We don't have to hang our heads low for anything. Remember, 65,000 young people met this past January in Atlanta because they believe Jesus is relevant. This is not old and antiquated. The devil would just have us believe that. It's a lie from hell. Amen. Awaken to the reality that God's kingdom will never be antiquated, but everything else on the planet will be. And because life is short and our time on earth is brief, I'm asking you to pray about this. Let's step up our commitment to coming every week and bring others with us. I'm not just talking to the people through the internet. God is speaking to us. It's time to shift gears and get into a most serious posture that life is short. Our time on earth is brief. So let's make sure our lives count for the stuff that lasts forever, and people last forever. Who do you know that doesn't know him? Who do you know that's out there and they have their church wounds and they have their bad ideas about Christianity, but you know if they came here that God could use a fresh moment in this place to bring those who are far from God, that he might raise them to new life in Jesus? Yes. I mean, we are poised for that, for the glory of God. So let's step up that commitment. And in so doing, we will be making sure that our lives are counting for the stuff that lasts forever. So I'm going to pray for us, and we're going to dive into worship. And I ask you, would you do this afternoon? Carve out about 30 minutes just with you and Jesus. And just sit with this message. It will resonate back inside your mind and spirit, because may the Lord bless those who have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying. He will speak again about it. And just ask him, God, give me the strength to be used by you in this season where Satan is doing, an onslaught war against his church. But God's people all over the planet are saying, get off me. As my friend KB says, not today, Satan. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. We love you. We love you. We love you. But we thank you that you first loved us. And oh God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that your word has gone forth strongly today in such a way that it has unbound some blindfolds that Satan even uses on believers. Certainly he blinds the minds of unbelievers, but wow, he blinds the minds of those in church too. So thank you for everyone who came today to place themselves in some space where they can hear the word of God. And God, I pray that all of these lies will be debunked by your spirit and your power. Thank you that your word is true. And God, on that last one, the church isn't motivated. It certainly looks like that for the most part. But oh God, that's not true of Oak Leaf, God. We are motivated, but God, we sure could use the power of your Holy Spirit to step up and go next level with you in whatever it is that you're wanting to do here in our midst. And we know that that is this, advancing your kingdom for your glory, because you're worthy of it, you sweet, beautiful, lovely King Jesus. We love you, and we thank you, and we praise you. In your precious name we pray, amen, amen, amen.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. In our lives. in all of us. So we pour out our praise to you, holy. To you, holy.
Yeah. Sing it out, just the voice is ready.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you
This morning on our way in, we were listening to the song, and my wife just turns to me and she says, what a great timing to sing this. You know, we're seeing all this stuff happen with the Ukraine and Russia, and just a great reminder. She just leaning over, I wasn't even thinking that, but she just said it and made me think, yeah, it is really good timing. Lord, you know, your name won't be overcome. I don't know if you guys have seen, I've seen some videos come up with people in bunkers and shelters, and they're singing about Jesus. We get to do it in this place this morning. And it makes me think the same thing, like, church, what's wrong with us? Why aren't we here? Why aren't we showing up? But your name won't be overcome, Lord. So let's sing that. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, the silence fade. Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your name is a lie, the shadow can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Sing it out, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, silence fear. Father God, you do silence fear, and your name won't be overcome. We say that out loud, so we believe it, Lord. We need to believe it. So this morning, we're going to wait for you. It's hard to do. But you say, tell us in your word that those that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings as eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They'll walk and not faint. So this morning, Lord, we're just going to wait. We're gonna be still. We're going to be silent. We're going to slow down, take time. Breathe in, Yahweh. Words lead you on.
promise to me that I will rise in your victory. And you
week. Remember, slow down. He's in the waiting. He'll show up. He does every time. Love you guys. Have a great week.